And now to kick off tonight's lecture, I'm delighted that we have Michael Aizenman here from Princeton, and he's going to tell us a little about tonight's presenter. So please join me in welcoming Michael.
Thank you for the invitation. It's a pleasure to be here. I was invited to say a few words to introduce the speaker and perhaps a word about the subject. So let me start with the speaker. We are at Math Encounters. The subject is From Coffee to Mathematics, and it's by Hugo Duminil-Copin. Now, I would like to tell a bit of a story about who Hugo is. You know, normally when a kid is about to be born, a guardian angel is appointed who has some shape, some effect on shaping the personality and the future. In this case, by fluke, two guardian angels appeared on the site. One of them said, "I see a magician, somebody with fantastic stage presence. Perhaps you'll make it to New York." The other one said, who was local, said, no, "I see a mathematician, somebody profound. He was born at Bir-sur-Yvette, which is the French, which is the hosting the French Institute, Institut des Hautes-Etudes Scientifiques, which is kind of a French counterpart of our Institute for Advanced Studies in Princeton." He said, "He's local. I see a great mathematician, and let's keep him here." Well, they couldn't settle, so actually they combined both of them. Let me just offer a quick timeline for Hugo. He got his education in Paris and Geneva, high school and École Normale. For PhD, he went to Geneva, got his PhD in 2012. He had a great taste in selecting advisors, and was appreciated. His talents were quickly appreciated. Wasting no time, in 2 years, he advanced to the rank of full professor in Geneva. His research is on areas related to mathematical physics. In mathematical terms, it's probability, complex analysis, and combinatorics. Our interests overlap to some extent, and some taste, although he's, of course, spectacularly powerful and effective. One word about the subject before we come to the contribute to the recognition. In mathematical physics, for some of us, what's great about this is the connection which we see between mathematics and its manifestations in physical and other science phenomena. Some of us derive great pleasure from this connection. And I'll come more to that later. So Hugo's contributions were recognized in multiple awards. As you would see, he did not waste much time in his progress. In 2015, he was awarded the Early Career Award of the International Association of Mathematical Physics. 2016, a year later, New Horizons Award in Mathematical Physics. And as you all know, in 2022, he was awarded the Fields Medal. And he's still under 40, even today. Now, I had the great chance to meet with Hugo in, I think it was 2013, between these two. And we were both visiting the Weizmann Institute at that point. Just to convey the sense of the meeting, Hugo was a young fellow, very focused. We met in front of a blackboard. He likes to work with large blackboards. And he started to make a list of problems which he found interesting and open, and we exchanged views on this. I added to the list of challenges which I thought would be nice to resolve. And then he proceeded working alone with collaborations, some with me, some many with others. There's a very large crowd of people who collaborated with him, and those challenges, one after another, got knocked down. Not all of them, luckily. This way we are not unemployed now, still. But it was quite impressive to see kind of fresh energy, blood, clarity. As you would see, among his talents is, first of all, clarity of vision. He does not waste, he's not distracted and goes like an arrow to the heart of the matter. And in his presentations, including very technical colloquia or seminars, it's delightful to see him in action, where he starts from some very elementary observations, which make perfect sense, even not in a technical terms. And you wonder whether we are getting to real mathematics anytime soon. But then, after a while, you realize that he's now talking about very sophisticated stuff. And the transition kind of, you morph from one to the other, as he often does, very smoothly. So that's about Hugo. The subject is the hex game. And the hex game would be presented on the hexagonal graph, which is in front of you. And I just want to make some comments about this graph. The hexagonal graph was discovered by nature. In fact, that's, as you know, that's the structure of the honeybees honeycomb. And in early January, we visited Guatemala when there was a show of production of honey for the visitors, and they showed bees of a size about between 1 and 2 millimeters who nested under the ground, a couple of meters under underground, and still they produce the same kind of shape, which is, you may ask, how do you engineer that? Well, this structure is optimizing cell structure with minimal area. So it reappears in a very natural way without much without seemingly being guided by an overall engineering plan. It appears very naturally. Now, physicists do not waste good inventions of nature, and just a short time ago, I found in my mailbox this bulletin of this discovery research at Princeton, and it shows, again, this hexagonal graph, except that now it appears as the organization of photoreceptors in the new telescope, which is being constructed with the support of Simon's foundation in Chile, which would be looking very deep with a fantastic resolution. So if you take a chunk of that, that would be the hexagonal graph that you have in front of you to play with. Now, this hexagonal graph and actually the hex game itself is interesting enough to have been discovered apparently on a number of different occasions. The latest discovery, and as Kolmogorov, the Russian mathematicians, pointed out, worthy discoveries are made repeatedly, and they are often known by the name of the last discoverer. So for some people, this was called the Nash game, although Nash apparently learned it from others. But John Nash actually proved a theorem about that, and I think that Hugo would talk about this, so I will not venture there. So not to waste time, because I know that there's a lot to be said, I'd like to introduce Hugo.
Thank you very much for this very nice introduction, which I'm not sure I deserve everything you said, but thank you so much. Okay, so normally up here, yes, no. You said I was a magician. Okay, good. well, it's an absolute pleasure to be here. It's, wow, you are many, very good. So what I wanted to do in this talk is to tell you about one way of seeing mathematics. I mean, there are many different ways of defining mathematics. They are basically all of them, they share the same property. Oh, I'm French, so I really apologize for the accent. You discovered I was French before you discovered I was a mathematician, usually. So, but sorry for that, you will have to listen to me for 1 hour 30, but after, we'll get back to normal accent, don't worry. So mathematics, definition of mathematics, very different ones. Usually they share the same thing, which they are very restrictive, like reductive. You know, it's a theory of numbers, or it's a theory of shapes. It's a, So, I mean, each mathematician has his own definition. It's always a little bit reductive. So my definition is that mathematics is the theory of making links between different things. It's just the art of making connections between different things. And what I try to do in this talk is to push the idea as far as I could get by picking four things that have nothing to do with each other, a priori, but telling you that through mathematics, you actually see a connection between these things. And the four things are going to be the following. So there is going to be a game, and this we are going to play together. More precisely, you are going to play, and I'm going to watch you play. But so it's a hex game that Michael mentioned. Making coffee is going to be the second item. Ferromagnetism, the third one, and melting of polar ice caps. So I think at this stage, right, normally you all think, what is happening? I mean, this has nothing to do with each other. Clearly, the man is mad, right? So my goal is to prove to you that these things are actually connected. The madness thing, this is another point. But we are going to do that. And we are going to start with the hex game. And before you play, I want to tell you the rules. So it's a fairly smart game, actually. There is really, there are good strategies and interesting things to do with it. And it has the advantage of having very simple rules. So if you don't understand the rules, it's not your fault, it's mine. So let's try to do it like that. You have two players, okay? Let's say a blue or a yellow, and in your case, it's going to be orange and blue or something like that. And let's say Anaël is playing blue and Bastien is playing yellow. So these are French names that you will never manage to to pronounce correctly. But that's so Anaël is playing first, and she's going to color one of the hexagons in her color. So in your case, it will be I put like a blue piece on one of the hexagons. And then Bastien plays, puts a yellow, then Anaël, then Bastien, like that, back and forth. And they both have different goals. So Anaël wants to go from top to bottom, create a blue path from top to bottom. And Bastien wants to do a yellow path from right to left. Left to right to left, it's not important. There is no direction. You can play wherever you want. You don't have to play next to each other, but your goal eventually is to create a path. Blue, it's going to be from top to bottom, and yellow from left to right. Okay, so let me just make one example of what we could play. So let's say Anaël plays here, Bastien plays here, Anaël plays here. Notice that it's not next to something that was played. You really play wherever you want, and you keep going like that. And let's say after some point, you are wondering how long it's going to take, right? After some point, let's say if you reach this stage, what happened is that Bastien won, right? There is a yellow pass from left to right. So the game ends, and Bastien wins this game. Are the rules okay for everybody, for a majority of people? Okay, well, very good. So I was told that you should manipulate something during the talk. So please, you have a board, you have a friend or somebody you don't know in front of you. Say hello first, and then, you know, play a game of hex. I want you to play the game because you're going to see that we don't play so well first, and it's interesting to see how to improve. So please play a game. If you have a question, if you didn't understand the goal, just raise your hand and I will come to explain to you. Yeah, you play wherever you want. It's very important. You play wherever you want. Okay, I see some good games. Did everybody understand the rule? Yeah, roughly. So let's spice things up a little bit. And let me ask you a first question. Yeah, I mean, I didn't tell you, but you are going to be the people working tonight. So do you think that there is always a winner at this game? So who thinks there is always one of the two players winning? Okay. Who thinks that it's not always the case that you can make a draw at this this game. So the rest of the people didn't understand that this is a yes or no question, right? I feel that we are not at the same page. So there is a majority of people who were right, but because five people answer the first thing and two the second one or something like that. I know that you think I cannot count, but I mean still, five and two are low numbers. So anyway, the majority was right. There cannot be a draw at this thing. There is always a winner. So let me explain to you why on one picture. And this is also one of the reasons why this game is interesting. So first, you will see it's a tactic game, in fact, right? It's playing well at this game is not so easy. And we play intuitively, we play very poorly at this game. But the advantage, so that it's a tactic game, but also that you cannot make a draw, makes it an interesting game for game theory. Like draws are something like then there are three outcomes, you know, winning, losing, draw, it's not so good. So in particular, that's one of the reasons why Nash likes this game and reuses this game. It was to develop his game theory, Nash equilibrium and things like that. And this was really, one of the things was you cannot make a draw. And let me show to you on a picture why this is true, and I think you will all be basically convinced. So you agree that you stop when one of the people win, one of the players win. So if there is a draw, basically you need to color all the things and discover that none of the two players win. So let's imagine that blue doesn't win, and let's make it just change a little bit our mind when we look at the picture. You know, this is something about mathematicians that we like to make mental pictures, right? It's not that we think differently about the world, it's just that we make mental pictures. And here's a mental picture I want you to have, is the following. Just think of three colors now. There is dark blue and light blue. So the dark blue are gonna be the blue hexagons connected to the bottom, okay? And because I told you blue is not winning, there are no dark blue hexagons at the top, because otherwise that would mean that they would be connected to the bottom and Anael wins. So the other blue hexagons, I'm gonna put them in light blue. And when you do that, and I could put you like a 1,000 by 1,000 board, you will still see it. When you look at this, you see the boundary of the dark blue area. And this boundary of the dark blue area is in fact a yellow path, and it goes from left to right. So in order to block the blue area from touching the top, there needs to be a yellow area, a yellow path. So if blue doesn't win, then yellow wins, okay? I mean, you would have to transfer that into a proof. It would be kind of just, yeah? I will repeat the question. That's very interesting. So let me rephrase. So there is another game that looks very much like that, where basically you put sticks either in that direction or in the other direction, like that. And there it's on a square. And it's basically exactly the same game. It has all the same features. It's not the same geometry, but it's the same feature, and actually it's related very much. I could have picked this game and tell you everything about what will come next would work with this game as well. So if you are used to this game, think about this game, it's perfectly fine. Yes, they are equivalent games. Okay, so what was I saying? Yeah, that there is always a winner. So the next question is, if there is always a winner, there is a natural question is there a winning strategy? So a way for one of the players to play perfectly in such a way that even if they are, you know, against the best player in the world in Hex, the player will not be able to win. Always, okay? So who thinks that there is always a winning strategy? Okay, so the other people now, I'm assuming, think otherwise because, so there is a winning strategy, but for whom? Do you think it's for blue? Do you think it's for yellow? So for the first player or the second player? First player? Second player? Okay, I'm not going to answer this because that's going to be your question now. So what you do is you take this, you turn it on the other side. There are two small boards. Pick the smallest one and try to find the winning strategy. So now your opponent is your friend, right? You both try to find the winning strategy. I'm not telling you if it's for the first or the second player. And if you really find it immediately, or which, first, congratulations, and second, you can try the 5-5. It's harder. Okay? So try to find, so you, everybody is clear about what is a winning strategy. It's a way to play that whatever what the other one is answering, you will win at the end. So try to find this for the small board. Okay. So maybe to give a small hint, it's indeed the first player who has a winning strategy. And let me tell you about just the first move. So the first move is this one. This is the right way to start. Okay, I mean, it's not interesting to start here or here. I'm telling you this is the first move. And let me also tell you why it's not a bad move, because that's going to maybe help you find the winning strategy. Does somebody has an idea? Why is it good to put the thing here? What you automatically get from putting the piece here? Yeah, I saw somebody doing two. Yeah, so here you have two options to connect to the bottom. That means what? That means that you can basically think that you connect it to the bottom. There is no question. I mean, yellow will never be able to block a connection from this blue to the bottom. So let me even, really give an example. So you are, okay. So here it's gray, here it's white, okay. So these two here, if yellow plays one of the two, then you play the other one, okay? And this is like just, there is no question. If yellow doesn't play one of the two, you don't even need to play yet. You will just have to react if yellow plays one of the two, okay? So that's why it's good. Let me even make now the two hexagons black in the sense that those one, as a blue player, I don't need to focus about it anymore. If yellow plays, I counter. If not, I don't. So now I'm there, try to think how to conclude. Following this idea, that it's interesting to make double connections, because then the yellow cannot counter you. Okay? So I give you a little bit of time to think how you can improve on this. Yeah. I saw several things that looks good, so let me push you a little bit closer to the truth for people who didn't get it yet. So here, look at these three hexagons and notice one thing. Imagine that the yellow doesn't play one of these three steps, right? Because now I need to look at all the options for the yellow. So imagine yellow plays, I don't know, here for instance. Where should I play as a blue to guarantee winning? Exactly, I see that, which means probably this hexagon. If I play this hexagon, notice that I reproduced exactly, well, actually, I reproduce exactly the steps where I have two connections here, so I cannot be blocked. So I'm guaranteeing that if yellow plays one of the two, I can play the other one to make the connection. So again, in this case, I win whatever yellow plays. Now I need to explore all the options. Yellow doesn't have to play one of these things. So in particular, yellow could play one of these three. In this case, if I play blue here, I will have, you know, yellow can block me. So in this case, what do you think should I play? In this case, I should play exactly here, because now I will have two options here, and I'm back into the situation where I'm certain to win. Okay? Same thing if I play like that. And this is the most interesting move from the yellow. This is actually the right way of playing. Again, it will not guarantee that yellow will win, because is a second player and I'm going to play perfectly, but at least that's the smartest move. And I think you can rethink about your first game. I don't think so many of you try to play at distance two very naturally, right? We have a tendency to play nearest neighbors in some sense. Sometimes we play very far because we think, okay, if the rule allows it, probably it's good. But in fact, we don't really think that way. That typical distance, both to annoy you or to win, is to play distance two. So in this case, try to think for a minute. I just give you like 30 seconds or 1 minute. Where should the blue player play to guarantee winning in this case? So that was the smartest yellow move, but it's not going to be sufficient. Blue is still going to be able to win, but he needs to be careful, he or she needs to be careful about where to play. So where should the blue play now to guarantee that he's going to win? Where blue should play. Okay, I hear a lot of noise, so that means people are debating. It's very good. So, okay, I need now to proceed a little bit further. I would love to give you 5 more minutes. But the answer, I heard it, is this one. Why is this one the right answer? Because notice that now I cannot break the connection between these two blue, because I have two possibilities. So whatever yellow plays, I would guarantee. And I cannot break the connection between these two, because whatever blue plays, yellow plays, I would be able to break it. So there, at this stage, in fact, blue won. There is a small subtlety. So at this point, many people, I think, would think, okay, this is done. Actually, yellow can try to do something here. He can try to rush to create a very long direct connection, seeing here I'm lost, in 3 steps blue wins, so let me try to rush, right? And try to connect like that. And this is actually, maybe, you know, in 3 steps, it's now yellow is going to play, right? So he's going to play his first step before blue is trying to connect. So in 3 steps, he could win. But what you can check is that blue can easily block it, you know, still thinking that on the right he won. So he's going to just block the connection of the yellow and then play on the right. So this is the winning strategy. So this is the 4x4 winning strategy. And there is a 5x5 board. If you want, you know, try to think at home how to do the 5x5. If you enjoy this small enigma, this is a slightly harder one. Even 6x6 is doable, but very quickly, just the problem becomes too hard. With computers, you manage to get up to 10x10 or something like that. And we will probably not have time during this lecture, but actually, there is a very cool argument to prove that whatever the size of your board, the first player always has a winning strategy. So it's one of these beautiful things about math, where you can prove the existence of an object being totally unable to describe it. I will have no way to tell you how to win a 100x100 game. I don't know how the winning strategy looks like, but I know that it exists. Okay? So this was for the hex game. Now, let's try to imagine what happens if you play alone. Meaning, it's not a very interesting game. It's more that the hex game was a stepping stone for something a little bit more complicated, which is what happens when you randomly color the different hexagons. So imagine you play alone and you have, you know, a coin next to you. So I took a Fields Medal, for instance. You toss it, you know, you choose first, you choose an hexagon, you toss it. If it's face, if you see Archimedes, you color in yellow. If it's tail, you see Latin that you don't understand, you color in blue. And you repeat that for every hexagon. So you do it for the first hexagon, let's say it fell on tail, so you color it in blue, you take another one, you throw it again, it's tail again, so it's blue, take another one, throw. So, I mean, the place that you choose doesn't matter. You choose it, then you toss. Then here it was face, and you do it this for all the hexagons, at the end, you get a random coloring of the hexagons, right? So this random coloring, for instance, in this case, in this realization, blue is winning, right? But you also agree that the result depends on the toss, the coin tosses, right? So here's the right question is not who wins. There is no winning strategy. There is nothing smart in this game. It's just I'm coloring the different things. So the natural things to ask here is what's the probability that blue wins? So what do you think? What's the probability that blue wins in this game? Yes? So I heard 50%. Who agrees with that? Okay, who doesn't agree? Aha, so people who didn't agree with this proposition, what is yours? A probability hint is between 0 and 1. Any answer which is not between 0 and 1, you get out. That yes? So here, there is no game of who goes first or not, right? I mean, I can play it alone. I choose an hexagon, and I toss my coin. So there is 50% chance it's blue, 50% chance it's yellow. There is no first player or second player here. So did I convince everybody by saying that it should be 50%? Okay, very good. But that's not a good argument, what I said. So, but the important thing is that I convince you, right? isn't society working like that these days? So anyway, so it's not sufficient that the first thing is 50-50 because the second one is also 50-50. Third one is also 50-50. And if you think about it, I mean, I don't know, to check what you think in math, very often it's very useful to just make a caricature of what happens. So let's say somebody tells me it's 50-50 because the coin toss is 50-50. Then I will want to destroy this argument, and what I can do is something really exaggerate. So think that the board doesn't look like that. Imagine that the board is just made of one column like that. Then you agree that for blue to win, every hexagon needs to be blue because I need to go from top to bottom. But for the yellow, because there is only one layer, it's only one hexagon to be yellow. So there it will not be 50-50, and still I'm tossing my coins. So the 50-50 for the coin is not sufficient to guarantee 50% probability. So what do you think we need to add? What's missing to really get that the intuition of 50-50 is right here? Yes? Yes, the board is symmetric, right? If I turn my head like that, the yellow is trying to go from top to bottom and the blue from left to right, right? Yeah, don't turn your head. I can just do that. Well, maybe I should not have told you. So the yellow and the blue play symmetric games here. So they have the same probability of winning, and you cannot make a draw. So the sum of the probabilities needs to be 1, so the probability is 0.5. Okay? That sounds good? Okay. 50%, fireworks. It's just this, I love to do it in front of scholars, like students, because they are not allowed, right, in high school or in middle school to put fireworks in the middle of their slides. So I always tell them that it's a message of hope that at some point in your life you can do whatever you want. That in math it happens when you get a Fields Medal. So in this case now, to bounce on this 50-50, let me ask you a different question. What happens if I change the shape of the board? Let's say I take a rectangle, for instance. So I still put hexagons in it, but I take a shape that looks like a rectangle. There it's much less clear, right? Because there is no symmetry. Even if it was a square, actually, there would be no symmetry because the hexagons themselves, the symmetry that would work would be 90 degrees rotation, but that's the hexagons. If you rotate by 90 degrees, they don't look the same, right? So here it's a slightly more difficult question. You can do it with any, it's Valentine, so of course a heart. any shape, or Mbappé, that's another option. You take any shape you want. So Mbappé, oh yeah, in the States, I need to explain. So Mbappé is one of the best, I'm French, I have a contract that says that I should say the best soccer player in the world. And so you take whatever shape you want, you divide in four sides the boundary of it, and blue needs to cross from one to the other, yellow from one to the other. What's the probability of winning for blue? It's a question that was asked roughly under this form, but for a different model, by Deverson Wood in 1894. What's the probability of winning, and can we compute it explicitly? And the editor of the journal, it was the American Mathematical Monthly, thought that this was a cool question, probably easy answer, so you know, if somebody sends me an answer, I will publish it in the next issue of the journal. So the poor man didn't see the answer because it took 107 years to get the answer. Yes, that can be a long time, right? As a mathematician, you need to be patient, usually, right? So 1,284 issues for, we also learned the tables, that's good. And the answer is the following one, as everybody would have guessed, right? Yes, exactly. I feel that this is the right one. I'm putting it that at least you trust that I'm a mathematician, because otherwise, for now, you think, okay, the guy just plays games every day, which is a little bit what I do. But so this is a difficult formula. I will not even read it. There are some very complicated things, like the gamma function, etc., etc. But what I like with this formula, I also show it to very young kids, because we get all trauma. I mean, no, I'm not traumatized by this, but I mean, normal people are traumatized about formulas, right? I mean, for them, formulas is this thing that corresponds to having marks at school. And it looks like this is completely obscure, right? But what we don't tell our kids is that a formula is telling a story, in fact. And the mathematicians are interested in the story behind the formula. And here's the story. I find it very visual and very nice. Maybe you would not like it, but I like it, so I'm going to tell it nonetheless. And in order to tell you the story behind the formula, I need to tell you about a special kind of transformation of space. So if you take a soccer ball and you move it like that in your hand, you rotate it, you will agree that any angle I draw on the ball would be preserved by moving the ball, right? It's not going to change. Rotations don't change the angles of things, right? If I throw it, I do a translation, it's not going to preserve. No, the ball can go to the other side. If I drew a square angle, for instance, or if I take any of the angles there, it will remain the same after the transformation. If I pump air into it, it's going to blow, but the angles are going to be preserved. These are transformations of space that preserve the angles. It's called conformal maps. Do you know any other example of a transformation that will not change the angles? Don't hesitate. And there is no shame if you don't know. That's fine. Yes? Sorry? Ah, yeah, dilations was pumping. So that's a very good example. Like dilations, when I pump water, air, this is what I wanted to illustrate. So dilations indeed preserve the angle. Yes? The reflections is a very good example. It's not a conformal map because I was not precise enough, but at least it preserves the angle. The problem is that it doesn't preserve the orientation. An angle is sent to minus the angle. So it's not a conformal map. Don't go tell a mathematician that it's a conformal map because after they are going to come after me. But this, at least in the context of this talk, that was a perfect example. Very good. Thanks. That was the one I was expecting. Yes?
Well, it's not fair because I know, but a stereographic projection from the South Pole to a plane tangent to the North Pole.
That's not fair. Burn the mathematician, burn. Okay, good. So that's going to be related. That's why, I mean, here you see something, hint. There you see something. You see it represented in a different fashion usually, right? You see it as a map. Well, if I take a latitude and a longitude here, intersect orthogonally. It's still true there, right? I mean, otherwise, sailors will be in trouble when they use this map. So this map, this projection, called Mercator map, it's a conformal map from this minus the two poles, right? Because they don't really appear there. They are like extended. But it's a conformal map from there to there. And this is just to illustrate, so you knew another one, which was the Mercator projection. But there are many, many, many conformal maps in nature, many transformations. So what's the connection with my formula? Well, the connection is that this formula behind it, it's actually saying that if I take two shapes, Mbappé and a heart, and I'm able to transform one into the other one by a conformal map, then the probability of winning are the same. So it's kind of like a hidden symmetry that you don't see at all in the model, but the winning probabilities are the same. So there is a limit to take, in fact, when the size of the hexagons tend to zero, but let me summarize, they are the same. So it's a beautiful formula, and it's very deep because it's a beautiful story, and it's very deep because it says that there is like hidden symmetries in my model. And this, as mathematician, as physicist, as biologist, I mean, you always seek symmetry because the more symmetric the object, the simpler it is to handle. And let me give you one example that I love. It's issued from, I mean, you for parents, at least it would speak, you all saw this game where you need to put shapes in holes, right? Like the kids play that normally, not the adults. Even though we try to play to show our kids because we are a little bit panicking that the kids don't manage at all to do that. So you know, you want to put a ball into a disc, like a cube into a square. And just as a, if you would have to think, what is the first shape that kids manage to handle? The shape that, I mean, the babies, it's always the same shape that they will manage to handle, yes? The circle, yeah? It's always the ball. The ball is the easiest because you can turn it in any direction, it still fits, right? It's a much more symmetric object. Well, you know, mathematicians are just like kids that didn't grow, so we need like the most, I mean, as many symmetries as we can, because the more symmetry, the simpler it is to describe the object. And this formula is important for this reason. Because there are many symmetries, it tells you a lot of things on the model. And the person who got, who discovered this formula got the Fields Medal for it. So you see, it's an important formula. And this is not me. Yeah, that's Tasmirnov. So that was my PhD advisor. So I should actually correct the truth because you said that I had a good taste for advisor. So I chose indeed, I mean, I did my PhD with Tasmirnov, but I must say I was not the person who chose to do it. Like, I mean, I was lucky, so I was doing my master thesis with a Fields Medalist, Wendelin Werner, in Paris, and I was like really hoping to be able to do my PhD with him because he was a god for me. And I went to see him, and he told me, no, I'm sorry, you have to go to Geneva. So, I mean, the equivalent in here would be like, you live in New York, right? And they tell you, you have to go to this city that is tiny and that you never heard about. Well, I heard about Geneva before, but so I really didn't want to go there. It was like, oh my God, why do I go there? And it was, Wendelin was like, oh, there is this guy, Stasmirnov, you're going to see, he's doing great things. I went there, and 2 years later, he got the Fields Medal. So, I mean, I should correct and say, Wendelin Werner has very good taste for choosing my PhD advisor, right? I didn't have any credit to have on this one. So, yeah. So this random coloring is called percolation. It's a percolation theory. It was introduced in the 60s. And what is it used for and why it's called percolation? It's because it's a good model for porous medium. If you want to understand porosity, it's a good thing because it's kind of describing the object as a random maze. So you have to imagine, for instance, if we go back to the, I mean, if we imagine a coffee machine, you heat the water, and here imagine that the grains are these brown hexagons or yellow hexagons. If yellow wins, then water will never go through it, and you don't get coffee. Sad. If blue wins, so if space wins, like if white wins in this case, then water will go through, will get the aroma from the coffee, and will give you a coffee which maybe very, very bad. I'm not saying that you will be better at making coffee at the end of the talk, but at least I hope you understand that it's called percolation because making coffee is actually playing around the porosity of medium. And more generally, porous medium can be coal if you try to make a mask. It can be even, in fact, something like if you look at spread of a disease, you may be interested in percolation properties of your population, et cetera, et cetera. And to give you one more example of a percolation application, because this one is maybe a little bit surprising, when you look at ice and you imagine that sun is hitting the ice, then there is going to be a thin pellicle of, just at the boundary of the ice, there will be ice melting. And this water is going to percolate through the interstice, the holes in your ice. But now imagine that the temperature cooled down. So actually, I must say that for many talks, I was saying, imagine the night is coming. So then what the temperature cooled down. Then somebody told me, that you can wait for a long time in Antarctica to get the night. So imagine just there is a cloud passing by and water, then it's going to freeze, right? Because it's below 0 degrees. But what do we know about ice compared to water, to liquid water? No, kids love this experiment. It takes more space, 10 to 20% more space. So if water took all the space in the holes in the ice, when it freezes, it's going to want to have more space and it's going to just break the ice, make it create small pieces and the granite, you know that big chunk of ice is much, much more solid and much more resistant to melting than crunch ice. So the crunch ice is going to melt even faster. So there is, in fact, an acceleration of the melting of ice, which is due to percolation. That was for the good news of the night. I'm sorry, but at least on this one, we are not responsible, so that's already something good. But there are people, like Kenneth Golden, is a mathematician, is going to Antarctica and studying this acceleration mechanism of the melting of ice by a percolation thing. So what is the connection with what I do for a living? So let me tell you a little bit what I do for a living. So in order to illustrate it, I'm going to show you a picture, a video. So the video is the following. It's the same thing. We are going to color hexagons, okay? Except I'm going to start from everybody blue, except maybe the guy, the last column. And I'm going to increase the probability. So it's like coloring when I'm tossing a coin which is totally biased, it's always falling on tail. But now I'm going to increase the probability that each hexagon becomes yellow. So you are going to see yellow hexagons appearing in my thing. And more, because I'm increasing the probability that hexagons are yellow. And what I do is the same trick as earlier. I'm coloring in dark blue, dark yellow, the hexagons that are connected to the left, and in light yellow, the other ones. Okay, so this is just, don't worry, you can just enjoy it. And there now you see that yellow wins, for instance. He was losing and now he wins. So let me make the same picture, but on a huge board. So here it's the same, the dots are small hexagons that become yellow. And here you see that for a very long time, things don't move here. There are some hexagons that are connected to the left, but really they don't go far. And here I'm almost at 0.5, almost, I think 0.49. And then something very beautiful happens, right? You have very fast change of behavior, boom, for instance. And you see that you get very quickly from no connection to connection. And it was like from 0.49 probability of having yellow, so a little bit fewer than half were yellow, to 0.51. Like it's very, very fast change of behavior. And you even see this kind of pivotal times where a huge chunk of my medium start to be porous, like start to see the connection to the left. So this kind of behavior, it's called a phase transition. It's a brutal change of behavior in your system. I varied continuously the parameter, but yes, there was a very strong change of behavior. So the phase transition is basically what I like in life, next to many other things. In math, sorry, I like this very much. So it's a brutal change of behavior when parameters vary. And you know one, for many years, is the change of matter in water. At 0 degrees, there is a change, there is a phase transition, where you start to be an ice, right? Plus 0.1, you are liquid water. Minus 0.1, you are ice. Plus 0.00001, you are water, etc., right? Very brutal change. So this is not actually the phase transition I focus on. Let me tell you a little bit about the one that I like the most. So take a magnet and heat it. I'm very proud of this video. That's kind of my arty side. What I'm not telling you is that I burned myself at least 8 or 10 times before I managed to do the right thing, but this one is going to work. So I'm heating the magnet, and what is going to happen? Ta-da! Ooh. I see that people are focused. That's good. What is going to happen is that when you heat, at some point, the magnet is going to fall. What happened in this thing is that the temperature has an impact on the magnetic properties of the magnet, and at a certain temperature, it's called Curie's temperature, it's after Pierre Curie, at a certain temperature, it falls, just because gravity starts to be stronger than the magnetic properties. So this loss of magnetization is again a phase transition at this Curie temperature. And here is a picture of the Curie family, apparently having a very nice day. So 4 Nobel Prize in one family, but still, apparently, not every Sunday was... Anyway. Okay, what connection to percolation? Because I told you magnetism, so you start to feel okay, I'm starting to get it, it's going to connect it to the other things. So in order to connect it, I need to tell you what we do as mathematicians and physicists when we are facing something like that. We want to make a mathematical caricature of what happens. And here's a mathematical caricature is going to be the following. You take your magnet, and you are going to imagine that it's a collection of billions of billions of billions of tiny, tiny magnets. In fact, these tiny magnets should be the magnetic moments of electrons in atoms, but you don't care. You just want to say there are many, many, many magnets, and they are kind of regularly spaced on a, let's say, on a square lattice. Okay? And these magnets, you have to think that they are basically oriented at random. They don't really, it's so complicated as a system that the best you can do is to think that they are randomly choosing a direction, and let's simplify things and imagine that the direction is they are either pointing north or south, okay? One of the two directions. So if this is true, what you can do is imagine that you have your, I'm a mathematician, this is north, this is south, I mean, okay, whatever. So if the magnet is pointing that direction, I'm going to color the square in blue, and if it's pointing the other direction, I color it in red. Right? And if I imagine that this is a big magnet, there are many small magnets, I get some kind of random coloring like that. Okay, so it's not hexagons, it's not blue and yellow, it's squares and it's black and red, but you can notice that you can ask the same questions about both models. You know, what's the shape of the blue area, for instance? What's the shape of the boundary? Here you see something very interesting, right? I mean, if you look at the boundary of the blue area, it's not at all like straight. It's very rough. It's what we call a fractal. Well, you can ask the same question on both models. This is coming from ferromagnetism on the right, On the left, it's coming from porosity of materials, but you can ask the same questions. Can you have a blue path from there to there? And in fact, by looking at this model, it's called the easing model, by looking at this model as a percolation model, you get actually a lot of insights on magnetism. So you see something that at the level of physics makes no sense. You will not connect porosity to magnetism. There is basically no reason to think of this thing as the same thing. At the mathematical level, you know, if you take altitude, in some sense, you may think that there are like deep connections between the two phenomena, or at least there are ways of looking at the two phenomena with the same tools. So this idea of looking at percolation models that are hidden in other phenomena, just not porosity, it doesn't come from me. I'm not at all the person who invented that. It goes back a long way. But to tell you a little bit about the contribution that I provided to this area, here, if I tell you the color of this hexagon, for instance, you agree that it doesn't give you any information of the color of this one. Why? Because for each hexagon, I'm tossing a coin. So this can be blue or yellow. It has no impact on the color of this hexagon. Hexagons have independent colors. In this model, I didn't quite tell you how this model is going, but really, I'm telling you, you should think of many small magnets. What magnets like to do? They like to align, right? So if I tell you that this here square is blue, then that means that, you know, it's oriented that way, so the nearest neighbor, or at least the magnets nearby, well, they are going to have a tendency to align. They want to align. They are magnets. So here, you see that the colors of the different faces, they are just not independent. If I tell you this is blue, it's going to increase the probability that then the hexagons nearby are also blue. So this is called a dependent percolation model. There is dependency. And if I tell you information there, it actually impacts what happens in other places. And when I arrived as a PhD student, there was a huge discrepancy between the understanding of what we call independent percolation on your left and the understanding of dependent percolation models. There were already very nice things that were done, but there was a big discrepancy between the two. And something that bugged me was to be able to say such spectacular things on Bernoulli percolation and being stuck fairly early on in our understanding of other dependent percolation models. So in some sense, with my collaborators, we restarted almost from scratch with dependent percolation models to try to make the theory much more robust to be able to say things that are similar to what we managed to do for Bernoulli percolation, and in particular with Michael Aizenman, that was here way before me and contributed actually to discovering new connections between percolation and other phenomena. We took this percolation model, this dependent percolation model, and we developed a theory for them to be able to say things. So that's basically the connection between the two, is through percolation. So let me tell you one theorem that we managed to do with percolation, is to describe the phase transition of this mathematical caricature. The mathematical caricature of ferromagnetism, you want to be proving that it has the same behavior as the natural model. And the phase transition, in some sense in nature, you have two kinds. You have the discontinuous phase transition. This is the typical example you should think in mind, is water. If I cool down water, as I said earlier, at 0 degrees, there is a jump in the volume. So if I try to draw the volume as a function of the temperature, first I will not get this, so it should not be increasing. I mean, I try to tell the person not to make it like that, but we all have our specialties, so he told me every function is increasing. I told him, no, I don't think so, but he insisted. So he was running faster than me, I didn't want to fight. And so you should in fact get a shape like that, and then it should jump. And it's just discontinuous function. This is a discontinuous phase transition. If you plug now, if you do the same for a magnet, And you plug not the volume, because it doesn't change with temperature, but the strength of the magnet. Then it's going to decrease with temperature, and it's going to reach zero exactly at Curie's temperature, where the phase transition occurs, and then it's going to stay at zero. So there, the phase transition is continuous, because you get a continuous function when you draw the magnetization as a function of the temperature. And these are very different kind of phase transition, discontinuous and continuous. So what we did with Michael Aizenman and Vlada Sidoravicius is that we prove that the 3D caricature of ferromagnetism actually has the same behavior as real-life magnets. It has a continuous phase transition. And this, in some sense, is the beginning of a very nice story, because you can say many things about continuous phase transition, but this I can maybe answer your question later on this fact. So the link at the end was percolation theory between these four things. And let me mention one thing about it. So the Fields Medal is related to that. I wanted to show this picture because, I mean, the Fields Medal is an individual award, but this is twisting very much the perception of people of mathematics, because mathematics is, before everything, a teamwork. So you saw in the previous slide that, for instance, one of my biggest achievements was joint with Michael, who is here. And here is here are two other examples of collaborators that contributed to basically, I think, between you and the two of them, they contributed to almost all the papers that were relevant for Fields Medal. So I wanted to show them. So you see, I mean, they are touching the Fields Medal. And then I run with it, just to be sure that they don't steal it. But this is a teamwork, so it's a little bit of a pity that this is an individual award, but here is what I wanted to say about that. And I will let you with this gallery of monsters. These are other percolation models. Very different ones. This is, you know, modeling spread of a disease. This is actually the Bernoulli percolation, the one that I described. Just I made some nice colors out of it because this looks like psychedelic, basically. This is a three-color system, but it's also kind of a percolation model. And this, for instance, is a model that is related to localization of electrons in material. So you see, again, a completely different phenomenon, but where you can imagine thinking of it with the help of percolation. Thank you very much for your attention.
All right, we have time for a couple of questions. And if you want to ask a question, please raise your hand. I'll bring you the microphone.
Just clarification, if you would. It seemed to me like you were saying that Curie temperature is a hard point where the magnetism is lost.
Yes, like exactly.
After that, it's gone.
It's gone, and if you cool down the magnet, it reappears. So it's
not gradually.
It is gradual in some sense. The fact that it's a magnet really goes from what, I mean, there is a ferromagnetic phase where it's really a magnet. It goes to what we call a paramagnetic phase. This happens at Curie temperature. The strength of the magnet is going to be extremely weak at the beginning. It's a continuous phase transition, so it's going to get to something very weak before and then grow. So it's not that it's going to be immediately a strong magnet. It starts with very weak. Yeah. Yeah, and the function, as you saw, I drew it in a very strange fashion. So for instance, it's not differentiable. It has a very nice singularity, et cetera, that you can study. I mean, it's related to a lot of very interesting physics and math.
Hi, this is not talk specific, though this has been super fun playing the games. Thank you. What is the most profound math puzzle or things that you've worked on?
Whoa. Profound is not something that describes my way of thinking very well. I don't even know what to answer. I mean, I'm somebody of simple needs, so I don't know. You know, it's very... It's very subjective what people think is profound or not. It's very, very often related to your perception of the thing, like how much you get acquainted with the problem. So, for instance, a lot of what people call abstract is not abstract for the person who masters it. Right? Abstraction is a way also of describing something that escapes a little bit your imagination. Why am I saying that? Because a posteriori, when you solve a problem, it's very difficult to describe it as profound because you exactly made this journey to make it less abstract, less profound, right? So for me now, basically everything I did, I feel like, why not anybody did it before me? Like it's usually that the first thing you think as a mathematician is like, for years you think about a problem, you don't manage to solve it, you are like completely, you think nobody will ever solve it, and one day you finally solve it and you are like, why didn't people do it? I don't understand. I'm such an idiot to have worked for years. So it's very difficult for a mathematician to answer a question like that. At least it's very difficult for me.
What about a moment of excitement?
Oh, this every day. But
okay.
Well, I have this good, it's interesting to wonder why you are good at what you do. And I think the only good answer I have to this is that I perfectly enjoy not understanding. It's something that I actually like much more than understanding. So my point is that I'm having fun basically every day in my work because I don't understand anything 99.9% of my time. So it's very difficult for me to explain that. And this eureka moment that people refer to usually when they think of this excitement, it's also a small death for the problem, right? I mean, when you solve it, then you don't play with it anymore. So so I have these moments, but these are not the most exciting moments for me, not at all.
We have one up here. One. This is our last question.
Oh gosh, that's a lot of pressure. I'm not sure if you have children, but I was wondering. It seems like you really like games. Best games for encouraging curiosity and persistence. Best games.
The best game for me is to vary the games. So I have a very young kid. And one thing that I find amazing with kids is that they have this ability that we completely lose with society and education, just the ability to enjoy trying, right? So I'm just pushing my daughter to play tons of things as soon as she understands something. I'm going to sound like a terrible dad, but as soon as she understands something, usually I jump to another thing because I like to just push her to just enjoy being trying things. And so I would not describe one game. I mean, usually, same thing. When somebody gets good at a game, in some sense, it loses its flavor. So I would not know how to describe it.
All right. With that, let's give another hand to our presenter.
Thank you very much. Thanks.